My name is Vicki Schorsch. I am a middle school social studies teacher at Park Junior High School, and I'm here to interview today Mr. Jack Humphrey. He's a Vietnam War veteran. Our cameraman is Sean Robinson. So I'll go ahead and begin. Jack, can you tell us, first of all, where and when you were born?
I was born in Huntington, West Virginia on September the 19th, 1946.
Can you tell us a little bit about your parents, their occupations?
My father, a World War II veteran. He worked in industry and was a part-time farmer. My mother basically was a homemaker until my youngest brother went to school. Then she worked in a factory for a short time.
Okay.
He passed away a couple of years ago at 95. My mother's birthday was yesterday. She turned 96.
Well, that's awesome. Mm-hmm. Any brothers and sisters? You said the younger brother?
I have three sisters and two brothers.
And their names?
My sisters are Sandy Humphrey, Nancy Blankenship, Joy Tackett. My brothers are Roger Humphrey, who is also a Vietnam vet, only he was in the Air Force, and Jeff Humphrey.
Did your brother serve around the same time you did?
He actually went in before I did and got out afterwards. He served in Vietnam after me. He was at Tonson Nut and after I came home.
And what were you doing before you joined the military?
I was a college student at Marshall University in Huntington.
What were you studying?
I was a biology major.
With plans to be a teacher at that
time? I was going to be a teacher, and I turned out to be a teacher. I taught 35 years.
All right. Which branch of the military did you serve in?
I was in the infantry.
And enlisted or drafted?
I went through the ROTC program at Marshall. I actually was trying to stay out of Vietnam. But as I went through the college courses, I realized that the war might last longer, so I went into the ROTC so that I could at least have some control once I got out. If I was in the ROTC, I would be commissioned as an officer. And I was commissioned on graduation day in 1969.
All right. Then after you graduated with the ROTC and commissioned as an officer, then tell me what happens from that point.
I spent a couple months at home, but eventually, I think it was in August or September, I was sent to Fort Benning, Georgia for my infantry officer basic course. I spent, I think it was about 9 weeks there. I got a short leave to go home, but then I was sent to Fort Polk, Louisiana, where I was a training officer, training infantry enlisted men and draftees to basically go to Vietnam.
And that's prior to your going there. So that's
prior to me. Gotcha. I did that for almost a little over a year.
So excuse my ignorance, but as an ROTC student, did you go through the kind of basic training, like all of that sort of thing too?
We had a military science class every semester. Between my junior and senior year, I went to Pennsylvania for basic training.
Okay.
And basically, we went through the same basic training that the enlisted, although I don't think they treated us near as bad sometimes.
As what you saw when you
were doing the training? As what I saw.
And did you get any other specific training after you left college and
no,
entered the military?
No.
All right. How was it to adapt to military life after college?
Well, yeah, it was pretty easy for me. I know when we went to Vietnam, I grew up on a hill farm. I spent times walking up and down hills chasing cattle. I was out at night in the dark. I got dirty and wore clothes and got my clothing soaked with perspiration. But I always wondered how the city guys would handle it, especially the dark. I can't imagine the first night they went out, because no street light, no lights, and I thought that might be a little difficult for them. Plus, where we were at, we spent anywhere from a month to 6 weeks in the field with the same uniform, no showers, no changes unless we ripped a hole in them and had them sent out through resupply. And so, you know, I think I adapted easier than what a lot of the men would have. Of course, the hunters and those type of guys would have done okay. But the city guys, I always felt for.
So you felt like kind of leg up on that?
I think so.
Yeah. And so what, tell me about this ripping a hole in the uniform to, sounds like interesting.
Oh, there's, well, the uniforms were loose, but again, you never knew when something would happen. Lots of times the legs would get ripped or the seat had been ripped out. And one of the things about it, there was a lot of heat, a lot of perspiration. You wore it for a long time. You really didn't wear any underwear because it would have really been a problem. So that's the first thing you threw away when they issued you a uniform. And then, you know, if you get the seat ripped out, you're kind of in a bad situation, especially with leeches and things like that.
So tell me a little bit about, where did you serve?
From Fort Polk, I went to Vietnam, and I landed in Saigon. And they sent me up to On K with the 4th Division.
And now, what year and month was this?
I went over in, I think it was September of 70.
Okay.
But I went to On K, and they sent me out in the field for about 2 weeks with a platoon. And then they pulled us back in, and we pulled security around a helicopter pad. And at that time, the 4th Division was sent home. So then they sent me to the 101st Airborne. And so I flew up to Phu Bai. And in Phu Bai, I was assigned to Delta 2501. And at that time, they needed someone who was, I guess they would call them, a support platoon leader. We were on a firebase called Brick that was only resupplied by air. There were no roads. And so I was put on the firebase to make sure that everything was ordered for the firebase to resupply it. And I also took radio messages from the field, from the units in the field, to get their, what we called a log, their resupply. They were resupplied every 3 days. So they would call in what they needed, and then I would I had radio telephone operator who would transfer that back to the rear, and then I would make sure it got out to them.
So you spent a lot of your time on the firebase?
At that time.
Mm-hmm.
I spent 3 months, I think, 3-4 months there, and it wasn't a pleasant job. We had a meeting with the colonel every night, and he was often upset because of things that were happening. And I was the last guy on board. And so I got to be the whipping boy. And so, but I understood that he was under a lot of pressure. And that's okay, I would take it. But he came by one day and asked, he said, "Humphrey, would you like to go to the field?" I said, "Tomorrow, sir." And he said, "I'll try to find someone in the field that will take your place," because the guys out there knew that I suffered quite a bit, you know, but not suffered, but I was the guy that got to be the whipping boy.
Now, what was it that made him so upset?
Units being in trouble, or, I mean, there was always something going on. Now, like I said, the firebase, I was in charge of resupplying. Sometimes he would want diesel fuel or gasoline or water or something. And there were times, this was during the monsoon time, there were times helicopters didn't fly. And it's kind of hard to move 500-gallon blivets, which is what this stuff came in, out there without a helicopter.
So just his frustration?
Overall. Yeah. Oh, I can't blame him. I would have been frustrated too.
So now you end up with you go out in the field.
I go out in the field. They assigned me to the 3rd Platoon. A Lieutenant John Baker, who I'd met before, great guy. He had trained a platoon. They They were one of the best. And so I took his platoon. Commanding officer was a guy by the name of Roger Ebert. And so, you know, I took my platoon. Like I said, they were trained. Kind of wild and unruly in the rear, but they were good soldiers when you hit the field. They knew what was going on.
So you took the place of Baker?
I took Baker's slot, gotcha. Yes.
And so what kinds of things did you do with these fellas?
Well, we were transported to the field through helicopters. Anytime we moved, usually it was by helicopter. We would land, we would be assigned a mission to maybe scout trails, look for you know, any kind of bunker systems or whatever. Basically, we were moving down the trail, trying to make contact with the enemy. And when we made contact with the enemy, we would pull back, and then they would use artillery or gunships or something like that to try to eliminate them. The problem is, most of the time when you make contact, it's a kind of a surprise. And if they see us coming, then that usually required some of us getting hurt. So, right. But
your role was to lure them out so that the guns could come after
them. I've said that we were bait.
Yeah,
we were bait. We walked down a trail, and hopefully we saw them first. But while I was there, it was towards the end of the war. The war was the year before. They had lots of contacts, and we didn't have too many contacts while I was there. One bad one, but the rest of them were, you know, suspected. We thought we heard something or whatever, and so we would, you know, basically though, we were just trying to make contact.
Now, how many men were in your platoon?
Well, it varied. We never were up to the number that we were supposed to have. So usually around 20.
And is that because of the kind of the war winding down, or that?
Well, guys were going on R&R, and sometimes you get, you know, new guys back, and people were going home, and there were always different reasons.
20 sounds like kind of a small.
Well, sometimes we worked that's a platoon. We had about 20. And usually if we worked as a company size, there would be three platoons.
Okay.
So you may have 65 plus the commanding officer and his group. So you might have 75, 80 people in a company if you went in as a company.
So you said that there were less encounters with the enemy in the year
while I was there.
Right. Any that stand out in your mind?
I'm afraid so. I think it was February 22nd. I'd just been in the field for a short time.
This is 1970?
This would be 1971.
Okay.
We were working as a company, but we had split up into three groups and, you know, reconning different areas. And so we went into night defensive positions, and we didn't go back together. We were on a ridge line. And there were three different setups on the ridgeline. And the guys in the middle thought they heard some kind of motion. They thought they were surrounded. So they fired a few, and we were downhill, so a few went over our heads and whatever. But finally, we thought we had them stop, but I think it was an M79 grenade shot from one of our grenade launchers hit in a tree. Above me and my RTO and a squad leader, and it exploded. And my RTO, a guy by the name of Jerry Flynn, he got some shrapnel on his leg, and the squad leader got a nick on his arm, which wasn't bad. And I got a little nick in my right backside. I call it my Forrest Gump wound. But the medic checked it out, and he said, "Well, Humphrey, you just have a piece of flesh about the size of a nickel missing. I think it's a flesh wound, but you should get it checked when we go back to the rear." So we were out there a month, and finally we went into the firebase, and they sent me back to the rear, and they said, "Nah, you've got some shrapnel down, a couple pieces of shrapnel down next to your hip bone." But there were little tiny things, and there wasn't any reason. And they're still there.
Are they?
They are still there.
So there was never any...
No, they were too small to even go after to start with. And the wound had basically healed by then.
So this skirmish was, your injury resulted from friendly fire?
Probably from friendly fire. Although there were individual surrounds.
Right.
And then other than that, the worst one we had was on April the 15th. A unit from our battalion had flown in a couple of days earlier. They had been ambushed. They got everybody out except, I think it was the platoon sergeant. He was an E6, and I don't remember his name. But he was a nice guy. I'd met him. But anyway, we were going in to get his body. And so they combat assaulted us to a landing zone quite a distance away, and we walked for 2 days, I think, to get there. And on the third day, in the evening, probably we shouldn't have been going after the body at that time. It was probably too late in the day, but that's hindsight. But we were going in, and we were ambushed. And several people up front got wounded. And my platoon, although we'd walked point for 2 days, we were moved to the rear because we were the ones that were going to go up and get the body. But anyway, ambushed, and the captain called me on the radio, said, "Humphrey, get somebody up and try to get back wounded." And so I took a squad up, and we pulled quite a few people back. And several of them were seriously wounded. Couple minor skirmishes. Two people we could not get to, and they were confirmed as killed in action. They were already dead. One of them, actually the lieutenant, one of my men, had him up on his shoulder carrying him out when he thinks there's an RPG hit the lieutenant, killed him outright. But it opened up my man's side. His name was Jim Zwitt, and he opened up his whole side. He was very severely wounded, but we got him out that night and two others that all ended up surviving. But the helicopters couldn't come in after anymore. They were taking hits too, and I think maybe one of the pilots actually got hit in the leg. But we carried out five bodies the next day. And one guy that there was more injuries the next morning. One guy had been transported back. We ended up with 6 killed and 14 wounded. And that was the worst of it.
Now, and as you said, that was to retrieve them.
That was going after a body. You don't leave your, if you were out there and you thought they're going to leave my body out here and not send it home to your parents, it would really be a problem. And so you try not to leave anybody. And if you can, you try to go back and get them. Now that body and our two were retrieved later on by an Arvin unit who took I think they took quite a hit also. They lost numerous people trying to get those three bodies out. That was a little later though.
So after that, so that was the worst?
That's the worst. That was the worst.
And how about any lasting friendships? Who were some of the friends you made while you were up there?
Well, the thing is, the commanding officer, and the lieutenants were one group. The men in your platoon, you could not make close relationships with. You were friendly with them, but you couldn't be buddies because I was the guy that had to send them out to do things that they might not want to do. The lieutenant that got killed, McKenzie, the captain, and I was probably closer to him than anybody else while I was there. Now, once I came home, I kind of didn't want to think about the war. I didn't really want to make any contacts for a while. I taught school. Vietnam would come up, and students always would start asking questions. So I tried to be as discreet as possible, but still describe. I always tried to tell the truth to my students. Mm-hmm. I try to be as discreet, and I'd describe different stories and whatever. And I'd always tell the one about Jim Swift, that he was wounded, that severely. He, you know, the lieutenant, he was actually trying to save his life, and that we would put him on a, well, we didn't have a landing zone, so the it was in the middle of the night, helicopters lowered a cable, we got him on the seat, they couldn't get him, you know, they got him fastened in, the helicopter was taking fire, so he could not draw the penetrator all the way up to the helicopter, so they actually drug him through the trees, getting him out. And I did not know whether he lived or died. When they released orders and things that had social security numbers on it, about 20 years later, I get a call one night, and it's Jim Swift. He says, LT, do you think this is? And I said, I thought you were dead. And so he calls, we have a reunion and get together. And Swift and I communicate all the time. Bob Gervasi from New York, he's a great guy. Randall Kuziak, who we called Savannah. Well, one of the things about Vietnam, I didn't know anybody's first name, I don't think. You either call them by their last name or their nickname. Well, Randall Kuziak, I don't think I knew his name till I got home 20 years later. He was Sylvester, because he had a mustache. He looked like Sylvester the cat. And so, I have contact with him. We just had a reunion today, and I saw several that I hadn't seen. Well, one guy we hadn't seen for 47 years.
Wow.
And so, you know, when you're over there out in the woods, I don't think a lot of people realize you become family. I was a little country guy from Ohio, back in the woods. I go in, I have all these guys, got a guy from New York, a guy from Chicago, all these. We have numerous Afro-Americans and their group. We have Hispanics, we have Mexican-American, we have Navajo Indian. It's a very diverse group. And back in the 60s, these groups didn't always get along. But when you get put out there and you depend on each other for your life, we become family. And it's really your second family.
Now, did you find the diversity, that ethnic and racial diversity, as well as you mentioned, like country boys and city boys, I mean, did you learn a lot from each other? Did you find, like, doing your job?
You learn some. It takes a while. When you're a new guy, nobody wants to get close to you because you're the guy that's going to make a mistake that gets people killed. Now, being a new lieutenant, who now I'm the boss, and then they find out you went through ROTC. You're not really regular Army, are you? And they don't know whether I know anything or not. And so there's a long feeling out process. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that wins a lieutenant over, he has to know how to read a map. Now today they got GPS and everything. We had a map and a compass. And if you didn't know how to read a map, you couldn't call in resupply, you couldn't call artillery, you couldn't call a medevac ship. You couldn't do any of that, so you had to know how to read a map. And they figured out after a short time, when we disagreed where we were at, and I was right and they were wrong, they quit checking on me. They thought I knew how to read a map. So that helped, you know, get into the group. Now, again, we had some Southern guys and the black guys didn't always get along. Until, you know, in the rear area, which we didn't get to go to very often, they would stay separate. Even out in the field, they stayed pretty well grouped together. But when it come time to move, We all mixed together and we all worked for each other. And, I can't ever remember having I know there were a lot of racial problems going on at that time. My group, I don't ever remember us having a problem.
Great. So now you said once you came home, you were kind of putting it behind you. Did you not have any contact with any other?
That's when I flew home.
When did you come
home? I came home in end of June of 71. Landed in Washington State, flew to O'Hare here in Chicago, stayed a couple hours there, flew to Cincinnati, stayed the rest of the night there, caught a plane to Huntington, West Virginia, which was near my home. And at that time, I had really no major contact with the military.
What was it like coming home at that time? I mean, the war was not very popular.
It wasn't popular. Start with, when I was on the plane flying in, I was used to being in the field with pretty good temperatures, 90 to 100 and some each day, perspiration soaked and whatever. And we got on the plane, they had air conditioning, and I froze to death. I asked the stewardess, I said, "Can I have a blanket?" She said, "Are you ill?" I said, "No, I'm just walked out, come from Vietnam." I said, "I'm freezing." But then, when I got home, my family was there to greet me, nothing else. I mean, naturally I had short hair. At that time, long hair was in. I think that's one of the things I'm kind of disappointed with today. Soldiers come home, they're greeted as heroes. We were not greeted very well at all. And it kind of hurts that, and I think a lot of the people who are welcoming them home were some of the ones who would have spit at and cursed us. But I'm not sure. Yeah, some maybe. But hopefully we don't do that to our veterans anymore.
Did you have many friends back home who had served as well, or?
Besides my brother, no, not really. At the high school that I had gone to, there were two younger men. But I was going to college. They went straight into the military. They were both killed within their first 2 or 3 weeks in country. Several others that at the time I didn't know who all went into the military. I found out since several, but no, I didn't know of anyone at the time.
Now, once you came home, was it difficult to make the transition back to the U.S. and peacetime?
No, not for me. A lot of people, I would think about, have dreams every once in a while, but I've never really had any problems readjusting. Maybe because I went straight into my, straight into my vocation, started teaching. I was too busy making lesson plans and doing all that stuff. And then eventually, I wasn't home very long. I met this young lady who we dated for a little over a year before we got married.
So you met her after you
I met her. Well, I knew her sisters prior, and I'd probably seen her, but I hadn't, she was much too young for me before I went to Vietnam. She was 19 when I got back.
So you were a biology teacher, you said?
I was a biology teacher.
And you began that right after you...
Shortly after coming home. I'd student taught at a local high school. The biology teacher that I'd taught under had become the principal. And he knew me, and they needed a science teacher. So they hired me just as a science teacher to start with. But their biology teacher left the next year, so from that time on I taught the biology courses.
I know you mentioned that you didn't feel entirely you know, welcomed when you came back. Did you encounter any discrimination as a vet, or did you feel like appreciated for that?
I saw more in our I live in a very, it's a small community, and probably very few of them even knew I had been to Vietnam, unless I told. And I saw it on a lot of it on TV, and so it hurt then. But.
Now, as the war went on just a few years longer, how did you feel when it came to an end? When
I was happy that the guys that were living got home. Whether apparently we weren't going to win the war, and there wasn't. I don't see any need to, waste human lives.
Now, you mentioned that you heard from Jim Swift 20 years after you came home. Did you have any contact with any other vets or any other men you served with in that interim?
No. See, Jim has been paramount in getting our group together. And nobody, I don't know that any of them knew where the others were. I'm not sure. I'm sure they were more buddies. They may have had home addresses and things like that, but I had nothing from that my platoon members or anyone like that.
So what was it like the first time you guys? So you met with Jim at a 20-year interval, or was it a bigger reunion?
Well, at that, we talked, and we call on the phone once in a while, and then they set up a reunion of our unit. D Company in Carrollton, Kentucky, and quite a few showed up.
And what year was that about?
That's 25 years ago, so it's 2017, so
about 92, 93, something like that.
But 25 years ago, and I went and met, and again that kind of brought up some of the memories and whatever. And so we didn't, they had a couple of reunions after that I couldn't make, but.
And when you say, was it difficult to reunite? Was it
no,
hard to
no.
Be reminded of some of those
things? Again, like I say, periodically I'll have a dream or something or see something that will make me go back in the past. And I thought, I think of things that we did that now I thought, gee, we were totally stupid to do that. And then others I thought, how did we ever get through? And so I fight the battles over again in my head or do things over in my head. And one of the guys just this morning, he said I suffer from survivor guilt because we had walked point for 2 days to get to where we were going, and then they moved McKenzie's platoon up front, and he got killed. If it had been the day before or they'd kept the same alignment, it would have been me in McKenzie's spot. And so I guess I may have some survivor guilt.
How do you think the serving in the war impacted your life in general? Like, do you feel... How do you think it's made you a different man?
Well, I went as a very naive, immature 23-year-old. And they gave me 20 lives to take care of. So I grew up pretty quick. And I felt my goal. I know the Army's key thing is mission first, but my main mission was to keep my men alive. Second, I tried to do the mission. And a lot of times they didn't want to do the mission, but we would do it, but we may not do it directly like the colonel wanted us to. We might come to an area and, we're going to go around this one because it looks too iffy. So, when I was teaching, Vietnam came up at least once a week. For 30 some years, somebody would, something would, in my talking about insects, there were more different kind of ants in Vietnam than I'd ever seen before. I saw Plecostomus fish in the wild. Different things that related to biology, and they would talk about personal hygiene. I said, how long have you been without a shower or a bath? And I said, I spent 5-6 weeks, same uniform, soaking wet every day, same socks. I said, it's a wonder that more of us didn't get hurt because they could smell us coming. Because we stunk.
Do you have your students appreciated the stories you've shared over
I think some did. There are some that think I told the same story too many times, probably.
I was going to ask, have you ever been out to the Vietnam War Memorial in Washington, D.C.?
No, I haven't been to the one in D.C., but the Traveling Wall I've been to it 3 or 4 times, and I found the names from my platoon that were on there. One of the guys that was killed belonged to my platoon. And like I said, the Lieutenant McKenzie's platoon lost the rest of them. And then after I left the field, my replacement was out, and about 3 weeks after I left, he and another one of my men were killed. So again, that's kind of survivor guilt too there, because if I'd stayed out there, I might have prevented. Yeah, but that's another story.
Yeah. What's something you'd like people to have learned from the war and the experiences veterans like you had there?
Well, I think it was Patton that said, "War is hell." The guys that are there on the ground, they do their best, and they get hurt and they get killed, and other people go in to try to save them, and it's really it's not something that you want. You want to try to get along with your fellow countrymen. You want to try to get along with other countries, and you don't want to have war. It's not very pleasant. I think the country has become, I don't know what the term is, but you see on TV what happens in other countries where they blow up buildings and bomb areas and whatever, and you don't realize that those people are hurting just like our soldiers do. They may not be for the same thing we are or whatever, but we all should try to get along.
All right, on that, thank you very much, Mr. Jack Humphrey.